good. All right. Well, thank you all very much for this third element of our amphibious conference. We're very pleased that General Walsh could come and join us from Quantico and return to CSIS. As many of you know, General Walsh has had a distinguished career as a Marine aviator, having commanded at the squadron, group, and then the wing level. In the last couple of years, he's been deeply involved with shaping the Marine Corps and expeditionary capabilities for the 21st century. He was the deputy commander at McSittick, the Marine Corps Combat Development Center. Then he was the director of expeditionary operations in the Navy staff, and now has come back to Quantico as the commanding general down at the development center there. We're very pleased to have him join us. General, the floor is yours.
Okay, thanks, Mark. Thank you. Okay, well, great. Thanks for allowing me to be here today, Mark, to be with CSIS. It's such a great organization, worldly known across the globe for being a world-renowned think tank. And I tell you, it's very important for us to get out here and work with the think tanks because it's so critical for us to kind of get the ideas and stuff. These kind of organizations get us to think. CSIS, a leader in the world in this area, gets us looking at things through different lenses. I'll also give a nod to our industry partners that are here on how critical you are in working closely with you, understanding what you're thinking about and where we need to be going in the future. So I'll look at that. I know that the conference today or the today what you're talking about is amphibious capabilities in Asia Pacific. I know you just had General Owens in here talking about that earlier, so I'm not going to get into that, but I'm certainly comfortable talking about any of the amphibious questions that you may have afterwards. But I'm kind of just really going to try to have like a conversation with you on where we're headed in the Marine Corps. I'll try to tailor it towards Asia Pacific a little bit and the amphib capabilities we have. But in general, just kind of show you and try to discuss with you where we're trying to head. And I think first I'll start off with where your Marines are today. If you look across the globe today, we've got about 33,000 Marines deployed across the globe. Roughly about a third of our operating forces are deployed today. So as you look at the tempo that we're on today, it really is about a 1 to 2 deployment to dwell that we've got. So even though at one point we had probably 30,000 plus Marines deployed between Iraq and Afghanistan, and we don't have anywhere near that many today, the Marines are out and about working with our naval partners, the United States Navy, and we're very busy. So I think that's something that is a forward deployed force, forward presence. That is our posture, being forward deployed. I think that's a key part of it. And right now, we've got the 26th Marine Expeditionary Unit that's over in the CENTCOM AOR conducting split ARG operations right now. So I think that's a key piece that we can talk about too, maybe Joe and Owens touched on that, of our disaggregation or splitting of our ARGs that has really become commonplace. And a lot of the capabilities that we have in our ships and the new ships that we're driving towards are really focused around that area to be able to conduct independent operations. So I think that's a key part of what we're looking at. The 13th MU, along with the 31st MU, just finished up Operation Songyang out in Korea. And we just completed that operation, very large Pacific operation with 7th Fleet and our Pacific partners out there. And now 13th MU, after completing that, is now on its way to the CENTCOM AOR to replace the 26th MU. 26th MU, on its way out, will stop off in the European African AOR as it heads back to the East Coast. We also have the special purpose, two special purpose MAGTAFs out right now, Crisis Response Africa and Crisis Response CENTCOM. Both of those are land-based, and I think talking about amphibious ships, certainly the one that we've got out in AFRICOM, we'd like to have on amphibious ships. We've got a gap in the Mediterranean. We'd like to have ships in the Mediterranean, and just because of the lack of ships that we've currently got, we're having to put those Marines ashore in a special purpose MAGTAF, being forward deployed, crisis response. We've got those Marines deployed between Morón, Spain. We've got them in Sigonella, Italy. and we periodically put them in Sidibe, Greece, and also deploy them to Romania. So a lot of capability, but they aren't on amphib ships there. In the CENTCOM Crisis Response Force, we've got them deployed across four different countries, conducting training, theater security cooperation with our allied partners also over there, but also conducting and supporting combat operations. And I think if you saw the report where we lost a Marine, Staff Sergeant Carden, a couple weeks ago, was operating off of the 26th MU. So again, the amphibious capabilities, we took those Marines, deployed them in and supported the CENTCOM AOR coming off the 26th Marine Expeditionary Unit. In EUCOM, we just completed a very large, probably the largest NATO exercise that the Marines have participated in many, many years, probably since the start of 9/11. We probably haven't been up there in Norway participating in a NATO exercise like that. We had over 1,900 Marines deployed in an exercise called Cold Response. And I think you're seeing the complexity, I'll talk about that a little bit, the complexity of the world today in where Marines are deploying to across the globe. And one of these is looking at Russian aggression that's going on in Europe. And part of our response to that is participating in a NATO exercise Cold Response and deploying up there, which was a very successful operation and a lot of lessons learned on how we've lost a lot of our skills in operating in the cold weather climates, both in our skill sets, but also the equipment we have. So we're looking at that real hard, too. And then in the Pacific, out in PACOM, we've got our special purpose, Marine Rotational Force, Darwin, down in Australia, training with our Australian partners down there, which is a great presence and training opportunity we've got out there in the Pacific, along with reestablishing our unit deployment program. As you know, when we were full up in Afghanistan and Iraq, we really had to pull a lot of forces out of the Pacific. With the rebalance to the Pacific and putting forces back in there, we have now four full-up battalions deployed there along with the rest of the MAGTAF elements. Slide, please. Do we have, is there, you got it, okay, good. Next slide. Let's see. So just touching on, kind of just giving you a broad overview on a scene setter of where we see ourselves going as a future force. First thing I would start off with is a big driver, I would say, is the complexity of the world we're in right now. For the last 14 years, really kind of been, in a lot of ways, heads down in Iraq, Afghanistan, focusing on that that environment we've got. Now as we shift gears and we look across the globe in the many different places that Marines could be deployed in or are deployed in around the globe, as a crisis response, forward presence force, the things that are driving us here really in a lot of ways is the complexity of the terrain that you see out there. And we look at that, the complexity that Marines will be operating. Certainly in the littorals, global environment, people moving to mega cities, Marines operating more and more in urban littoral environments is where we see a lot of this going. The technology proliferation that we see too is a real driver in how we're going to be operating. One of the things that I definitely look at is the technology is increasing so fast, and you hear about it all the time, our acquisition system and how we have to move faster. There's no question because the technology is moving very quickly, and not only is it an advantage for us to move quickly in that technology area, but the threats that we're dealing with have the same ability to do so. And I always compare it to when I was flying F-18s and the first time I got into a MiG-29 fighter, and I looked at it and we had seen videos of what a MiG-29 could do and how impressive it was with its performance and speed and turning capability. But when I first sat in the cockpit of that and comparing it to my F-18, I thought it was back in the F-4 that I was flying years earlier. The technology wasn't there. It looked good, flew fast, turned well, but didn't have the technology that American industry could produce. Roll the clock forward today, and you look at the F-35 today, and it's out there. And you look at, say, the J-20 that the Chinese produced. Looks very much like the aircraft we're producing with the F-35 and that capability. Now, what's it look like when you get inside the cockpit? Is it the old technology, or is it today's technology? And my question will be, can we keep pace with threats with the technologies that's going? Or does their capability get put into the cockpit or into the aircraft, outpace what we can do in our acquisition system? So I think that's a very big challenge for us. Information is a weapon. I think that's a key part of everything we do today. It's different than generations before us have had to deal with. When you look at what Russia has done in Crimea, Ukraine, Georgia, ISIL, as you see that black flag going into villages in Syria and Iraq, it gives a different message. Social media, with beheadings by ISIL on social media, brings a whole different message that we've got to be able to deal with, and we're really reworking within the Marine Corps how we're going to use information as a weapon. And along with that is on the battlefield is signature, both offensive and defensively, how we use the deception, how we hide our signature, how we use our signature to our advantage. That's a whole other area that we have not really had to deal with since the Cold War. But we're seeing that across the globe, both in Iraq, we're seeing it in Syria, and certainly we saw what the Ukrainians had to deal with in Ukraine. So, kind of the primacy of what we have to look at is continue our ability to maneuver. Marines travel light. We come from ships. We're amphibious. We use our ships as maneuver and our ability to maneuver from the sea. That's our advantage, but we've got to be able to maneuver in five domains. We've got to be able to operate not only on the air, land, and sea, but operate in cyber and space, and we're putting a lot of effort into that, along with exploiting automation. And a key part is this physical cognitive balance. It's not just all about precision kinetic fires. It's also about operating in the cognitive area, how we can outthink our enemy, how we can take big data, process it quickly, get it down to the lowest levels to create quick, rapid decisions on the battlefield. Our Expeditionary Force 21 refresh, we're refreshing that after only 1 year. And we put that out, well, I guess it's been almost 2 years now, but we're refreshing it again because we see the complexity of what's going on around the globe. And so you're going to probably see that rolled out here before the May timeframe, before the Sea Airspace Symposium. No surprises there in it. We've got a lot of changes inside it, but the main focus areas are naval, expeditionary, agile, and lethal. That's who we are. That's who we have to continue to be to maintain be ready and relevant across the range of military operations. The commandant kind of looked at this, and he kind of calls us, you know, the middleweight force. We kind of had been using that term of operating that middleweight. I think he likes to use the term more like a 167-pound wrestler. So if you're familiar with wrestling, you know, 167-pounder, he can move up if he needs to move up. We can do the major conventional operations if we need to move that up. We can move down if we need to move down, cut weight and move down. So we're operating in that area. We can work across the range of military operations. Our focus, really, in Expert Force 21 is to focus on evolving our MAGTAF. And I'll touch a little bit on what we're doing with Marine Corps Force 2025, which is a key part of this, but evolving the MAGTAF to operate in the 21st century. The key also is working with our industry partners. American industry, along with tech-savvy youth, we believe is going to be our offset and our advantage in the future as we evolve our MAGTAF. The information age Marines we're bringing in today think on their own, act on their own, and can operate in this high-tech environment very well. We use that, we think, as our advantage, along with American industry taking us in that direction. Next slide. Things as we evolve that the MAGTAF, this Marine Corps Force 2025 effort we've got going on right now. The commandant came in, and in his fragmentary order to us was to take a hard look at force structure within the Marine Corps. So we're right now probably about one-third of the way through a process of working with the commandant, senior leadership, of really digging down into the organizational force design of the Marine Corps. And doing that. So we've got that evolution going on right now. The next step on that, we've been in course of action development. We've developed two courses of action with Marines coming in from across the Marine Corps, have come in over the last really 3 months, and now we're going to present those course of action to the Commandant, and senior leadership at our April executive offsite. The Commandant has been very involved in refining, as a commander should refine, those courses of action as we've been developing them. He's been pushing us very hard on innovation. Some of you have maybe have been to our innovation forum we had. We had a science fiction forum. Brought in a number of Marines. We had them compete with writing ability across all ranks to come in on a science fiction forum. We had science fiction writers that led the groups, the small groups that we had brought in. I think we brought in about 19 Marines and sailors. And as an example of that in science fiction forum, we had a Lance Corporal that came in, had his master's degree, and already written a science fiction book. So these were out-of-the-box thinkers, very unique, very innovative, talented, and we're helping them write on what we think the future operating environment should be. So that's an example of that. A lot of wargaming and a lot of science and technology taking place. Our wargaming, we just finished our Naval Services wargame, which is with the Navy, did that down in Norfolk. In fact, next week we've got an out brief at the Pentagon with all our senior Navy and Marine flag and general officers from that wargame. We also finished our Expeditionary Force 16 2 weeks ago, did that also down in Norfolk, completed that, where we really looked at compositing the force. So if we have to go somewhere in the globe, how do you bring together CONUS-based forces, special purpose MAGTAFs that are deployed, along with amphibious task forces to bring them together to conduct combat operations. This summer, we're going to be operating in RIMPAC 16, and one of the key pieces of RIMPAC 16, along with working with our Pacific allies in the Pacific area in working with amphibious operations, we're going to be doing an experiment with our new experiment force that we've got. And 15th MEU is the experiment force for this RIMPAC operation with 3-5, 3rd Battalion, 5th Marines is our base unit of our experimentation force. They're going to be deploying from Camp Pendleton into 29 Palms as part of the RIMPAC. We're going to put them into an urban combat environment at 29 Palms. They're going to be operating with against an opposing force. Both the friendly force and the opposing force will be using science and technology and experimentation. We'll be using both air and ground unmanned systems, ground systems that can sense, detect, track, laze, and fire weapons to be able to push the operating environment out to see how we're going to be operating in the future. That experimentation force is going to continue. They'll stay CONUS-based, and it'll deploy as part of 31st MEU on their next deployment as that base force that continues to bring in experimentation as we continue to work the war game experimentation and science and technology into our campaign of learning across our 14 warfighting challenges. Let's see. A key part of all this, I think, is rapid decision-making, keeping tempo up. No surprise there. That's the Marine Corps. That's who we are. Distributed operations. Can we distribute? Can we do the C2 that allows us to distribute? Can we do the command and control? Integrating with our soft partners is a key part of that. And then continuing to use the sea and our amphibious ships as a maneuver base to be able to outmaneuver and provide overmatch at the point of choosing. On integrating with our naval force, Cooperative Strategy 21 is a real basis of where and how we operate. So a key part is deterrence, sea control, power projection, maritime security, and probably the most important one is all domain access. And what we're seeing is a concept that we're in the process of writing with the Navy is a littoral ops in a contested environment, and we're working very hard from a standpoint of what is the amphibious force bring, what do the Marines and sailors on the amphibious force bring when it comes to littoral ops in a contested environment. Things like sea control, power projection, composite warfare, what capabilities do we have out there? Certainly when you bring in amphibs with fifth generation aircraft capability, it changes the equation of what the amphibious task force looks and what we can bring when it comes to battle force operations and what to the naval force brings. Our MEFXs are very focused. All of our MEFXs this year, our Marine Expeditionary Force exercise, they do one a year, are all focused on operating command and control from the sea. So that is our focus in really trying to drive into that area of how we're going to work with our naval partners, along with relooking our command and control relationships and how we can integrate much more closely and merge command centers with the Navy to be able to operate in a more of a combined way. Operating in a contested environment, networking, rapid fires. The key thing, I think, what we're really trying to do on the ground is just like I think we're trying to do at sea. When you look at things like naval integrated fires, counter-air, distributed lethality, being part of that, and how do we connect into that? What capabilities we have with advanced base operations? How do we bring our capabilities from the shore to connect with the sea base to be able to operate at or on from the sea base and on land, and how we do that? A lot of good work in the fleet being doing with that on how we're exercising to that, but trying to process and push information down to the lowest level. So whether it's distributed lethality on cruisers and destroyers, or whether it's down to the individual squad level, on how we're going to be able to do that and push that information around. A key part that we've got is on information warfare. We are taking all the different pieces we have in information warfare that we've got spread throughout the MAGDAF, whether it's command and control, cyber, electronic warfare, offensive, defensive, PSYOPs, information ops, and military deception. Those pieces that we've got in different areas, some very small that we're going to grow, and bringing them together in some type of information warfare group that we're going to have in the future to be able to operate. Part of this Marine Corps Force 2025 effort I was talking about is, the decision is, do you keep it up high and push deployments down, task-organized deployments down to the lowest level, or do you keep it up at a higher level and operate that way, or do you just you put them down there in more of a permanent structure? So that's some of that we're working in, but we know in that information warfare area, the Commandant's very clear guidance to us is we've got to grow that area to be able to operate in the future area. I think we're on a good track with our amphibs. General Owens probably just talked to you about that and how successful we've been on the path we are developing new ships. The America coming in with Tripoli, LHA-8 coming in behind that are going to be fantastic warships. LPD-17, we couldn't be more pleased with that ship and the way that ship's been coming along, and it allowed us to really bridge that with LPD-28 and now onto an LXR, which will be a derivative of that that class ship and continue to give us those capabilities that I talked about earlier to be able to operate in a more of a distributed fashion. Last I'd touch on is the focus on exploiting the competence of our individual Marines. I touched on that earlier, but really looking at trying to push more and more of this ability to operate in this complex environment down to the lowest level. So recruiting key Marines in the right skill sets, getting that talent in, keeping that talent, and being able to get the right information down and be able to get them to operate in that environment. Slide. And really, this is my last slide here, I would say, is this is kind of where we see all the technology going. We're doing a lot of work in these areas and these technology advances. These are a lot of things we're doing in our experiments that we've got going on, whether they're limited objective experiments or large force experiments, but really working in these areas to continue to advance technology to allow us to rapidly make decisions, bring information in, and make sense of it. You know, some of the things like autonomous learning systems that we've got here, things like you see in your vehicle within Entrix or Waze, you use that where it learns your pattern of how you drive and how you get to where you need to go. It's taking that information. How we use that for intelligence to be able to determine how we operate. F-35 has a lot of those kind of capabilities. So as I look at the technology of fused sensor information that the F-35 has, that's the type of information that we want to get across the battle space. A lot of the things we're doing at the Marine Corps Warfighting Lab is leaning on a lot of this type of technology advances we've got, being able to miniaturize and get things smaller. The things that you're seeing that would be on the F-35, fusing information and getting it onto the helmet of a pilot and being able to share that information across the battle space, we're working real hard to be able to do that down to the lowest level of our ground combat forces. So again, that speed, that qualitative edge, working with industry, our partners in industry, and getting this technology down to the lowest level with the tech-savvy youth we've got today, we think that's going to be really our offset that's going to allow us to move in new directions. Last slide. I would just finish with looking at the Asia-Pacific area, the partners that we've got out there. There's no question we've really kind of re-emphasized our focus back in there. The Asia-Pacific area is critical to the global economy, you know, really maritime international crossroads. Marines and sailors have always been part of that area. I think right now MAR-4 PAC probably has about over 85,000 Marines deployed out in there, over 640 aircraft. The first place we're bringing F-35 is out to the Asia-Pacific area. And bringing that capability out there next year. So partnering with our Asia-Pacific partners is critical to the way ahead. All you had to do is really probably listen to me or to General Owens on how we don't have enough ships, that the critical piece to this is working with our partners together from an allied perspective, coalition perspective, to work together as we see in exercises like RIMPAC or Dawn Blitz, to learn from each other on the unique capabilities we all bring together and be able to operate in a way not only to be able to conduct power projection or sea control, but also from a deterrent standpoint. And the building the alliances, the partners that we can build out in the Asia-Pacific area is so key to maintaining peaceful conditions out in that area. And last I would say is one of the challenges that we continue to have is with the budget is trying to do that balance between readiness, our force structure, and also looking at what capabilities we're trying to bring in. And we talk about capabilities, it's both new modernization, but also the capacity that we need to bring in, which is a very careful balance. But I think with the changing operating environment that we've seen, I think from a Marine Corps standpoint, what we're seeing is a turning of the ship, and we're starting to modernize the force. We're seeing our budget projections, the money we're putting in now is we're seeing that we've got to put money into modernization if we're going to keep pace with the threats we see out there. And so when you look at the capabilities that Russia just showed what they had in Ukraine, some pretty exquisite capabilities, certain electronic warfare area, that we have not dealt with in a long time. And you look at the conventional capabilities that they brought into Syria very rapidly and were able to exercise in that area. The capabilities we see with the Chinese and that ability to bring rapidly large or capable military capabilities in to the force very quickly in the Asia-Pacific area and what's going on in the South and East China Seas. And the challenge that that's going to present and why that's going to keep have us having to keep pace with the threats we see from there, along with North Korea and Iran. So those kind of things, I think what I would say is our Navy partners and us are truly looking at this high end. We are no longer just focused on counterinsurgency and defeating that. That's a piece of it. We're going to continue to be involved in that. But we can't stay focused on that. We've got to continue to move our amphibious forces forward, our naval forces, to be able to deal with the high-end threats we're seeing around the globe.
Exercise my prerogative to ask the first question, which is, you said that there's a force structure review going on. Do you expect any new kinds of capabilities to come out of that as a result of the environment we're moving in? For example, we were talking before we came in about ISIS having UAVs, which is right. A capability we really haven't faced before. Will we see LAD, short-range air defense, coming back? Coastal defenses in some way? What might we see in terms of new or different kinds of capabilities?
Sure. The first thing I would say is on the offensive side, what we're definitely seeing is a proliferation in manned and unmanned. Manned-unmanned teaming in the unmanned area. So a lot of our science and technology efforts are in the unmanned, both on the ground and the air. So we know we've got to move in that direction. We see the advantage of UASs, in that case, in trying to grow. So General Davis and myself, working closely with the Commandant, trying to figure out what our family of UAS systems needs to be. So certainly we need the small UASs, and miniaturization is allowing us to take some of these small UASs and bring a lot of capability into them down to low levels. But when you start talking about miniaturized weapons, those kind of things, we're now starting to get more into a higher. Now, some of those small UASs, we can turn those into weapons and kamikaze-type capabilities, and we're experimenting with that at the small level. At the middle level, when you start looking at more of a regimental-sized front, we're getting into the group 2-3s, we're seeing a lot of capability with the miniaturization of payloads, packages, that we can get those, whether they're a signals intelligence package, whether it's miniaturization of a weapon, or it may be a package that's able to look at our own signature and see how much we're emitting and what our signature would look like. So we're growing a lot in that area, along with looking very hard at what do we need in the Group 4, Group 5 UAS area. Probably the primary thing we're going to look for, though, is it's going to have, if the Marine Corps is going to move to a Group 4, Group 5 UAS, something larger with those kind of long endurance, longer range, more payload, the primary thing we're going to look for is something that's going to be able to be ship-based. That's who we are, and we want the ability to be able to come from a ship, which is a unique challenge for us. On the threat side, on the defensive side, absolutely we're starting to see that proliferation. We see it in Iraq, we see it in Syria, certainly saw it over Ukraine. UAS is up at, not only targeting, looking at the electromagnetic spectrum and the signature that's out there and who's where and what they're doing, and being able to quickly target and bring in precision weapons or area fires. That's a major concern for us. It's a threat we haven't had to deal with in a long time. Remember when we had Hawk batteries? We've had Stingers. We had a program a ways back, right at the beginning of going into Iraq, a program called CLAWS, which was a capability to increase our air defense capability. But rapidly moved away from that with the threat we were dealing with back at that time. Now we're really looking hard at the gap we've got in our air defense capabilities. One of the things that we think is very critical to that is sharing information. So bringing in things like our Gator radars, which are ground air task-oriented radars, which are both on for the support of the air combat element and air surveillance, but also on our ground combat element, being able to look at guided rockets, artillery mortars, inbound missiles, and be able to see that. Our sensing capability is going to be probably, I would say, fifth generation sensing capability with Gator in a program called Common Aviation Command and Control System. So I think ability we have in the Marine Corps is having some high-end capability in F-35 along all the way down to a rifleman with an M-16. And trying to connect those capabilities is being able to fuse this information. I think Marines have always been very good with that, with our command and control capability. Sharing that now down to the lowest level and pushing that out with these distributed packages that will go down to our direct air support centers, our small teams of air command and control capabilities that will push down to the lowest level that can take all the sensing information and fuse it, we'll be able to see the UASs that are up there, or any inbound air-breathing threats or cruise missile threats. We'll see them. Now the question is, your point is, how are we going to shoot them down? Because right now, our only capability we have right now is our Stinger capability, other than relying on the joint force. So we're looking at that real hard, working with ONR on ground-based air defense. I think probably the direction that some type of mobile laser capability is what we're working with them is where we'll think we'll end up, and there's probably going to be a lot of success in that area. Things like the USS Ponce has been a leading R&D effort for the Navy and the Marine Corps, and seeing how lasers can operate in the future. Obviously, a large ship out there operating in that environment where it can generate a lot of power. Technology, though, is moving very quickly where we can generate that power down at lower levels in smaller, miniaturized fashion, get the kilowatts down, and be able to use that for a ground-based air defense. So we think that's probably where we're going to be heading in that area.
Great, thank you. Question, Sydney.
Thank you. Sydney Friedberg, Breaking Defense. General, I wanted to pull one of the particular threads you mentioned, this integration of all these different things related to information warfare, from military deception and PSYOP to, you know, the very, which are very psychological domains, to very technical areas like electronic warfare and cyber. What do you have currently that you are the basis of the things you want to pull together? And how do you integrate all those things when, while they all affect the enemy's perceptions, they use very different means and mindsets, institutional cultures to do so?
That's a great question, Sydney. I think if you kind of look at, we've got a lot of those capabilities currently spread across the Marine Air Ground Task Force. We've got some very exquisite capabilities, like some of our signals intelligence capability that we've got in our radio battalions. World-class capability that we've got that we've used supporting a lot of special operations capabilities, agencies supporting their capabilities or missions. That's an example. We've got a thing called the Marine Corps Information Ops Center that's located at Quantico. We built that to start moving us in the direction of information ops, psychological warfare, those kind of things, and how information ops can move us quickly in this information age. We've got that center that's there, but what we're seeing is, as we deploy small teams out from there, it's not going to be enough capacity. So as I talked about this Marine Corps Force 2025 effort, in that example, what we're seeing is we're going to have to build that capability down at our MEFs. So rather than have it just centrally located at Quantico, to be able to take that capability, put it in the MEFs, and have that. So that would be the EW on the signals intelligence, the radio battalion piece, cyber, defensive support teams, looking at where we would put the offensive cyber. So Marine Force cyber, developing those defensive cyber teams, are certainly something we're going to have resilient systems down at our warfighting level. So a lot of those Marines exist today. They're in our communications structure. MAR-4 Cyber is developing those teams in support of COCOM's requirements. But getting those into the MAGTAF at what level that we need to get them into is what we're looking at in this Force 2025 effort. Our Prowler community that we've had for many, many years in electronic warfare, changing those MOSs from the Prowler community to a MAGTAF EW MOS, the 7315 MOS, that's going to be tied very closely to radio battalion and also to UAS capabilities with signals intelligence, electromagnetic spectrum packages that we're going to be putting on our UASs. We just had 22nd MU with our RQ-21 Blackjack getting ready to deploy. We've gone IOC now on our RQ-21s, our Group 3 UAS. We just had a package called Spectral Bat that we just put out there on 22nd MU, and their workups, and a lot of success that we saw with being able to look at the electromagnetic spectrum on that UAS and how that's going to be employed with our MUs. The Cyber Electronic Coordination Cell that we started up about 3 years ago, bringing cyber and EW together in cells that we deployed with our Marine Expeditionary units, was probably the first step in this direction. These CEWCCs that we have deployed, working very closely aboard ship with the Navy signals exploitation element aboard the amphibs. Bringing that information together was a first step in that. I think that we've done it. So what we're seeing in the Force 2025 is pulling together the cyber capabilities we have, both offensively and defensively, the EW capability, ground and air, together, the radio battalion piece, along with the information ops, information warfare, PSYOPs, military deception, growing those capabilities that we have small sets of now. In this Marine Corps Force 2025 effort, as we grow that, I think those areas are going to be huge areas within our Marine Expeditionary Force that you've probably heard the Commandant talk about, that we're going to have to trade capabilities within the MAGTAF to be able to grow those capabilities. How many that force is going to be, I don't know. Probably somewhere between 1,000 and 3,000. We're going to grow in that area of Marines that is going to have to come from within the force to be able to make us a more capable 21st century force. Above. And I think over the last probably 2 to 3 years, we've already grown probably about 14 to 1,500 already. So it's moving in that direction, but the Commandant, by tasking us specifically to look at information warfare in his force structure review and his FRAG-O advance to contact that he put out in January, directed us to look at this. We put this together in the Marine Corps Force 2025. The two different teams that are looking at it, both are certainly increasing to meet the Commandant's intent, that IW area, and bringing it together in synergy. Now it's just a question of the CONOPS. Where do you keep it? How much do you push down? And I think the big challenge, just like anything that we do in the air combat element, is do you want it down at the lowest level all the time, or when it comes back from a deployment, do you bring it back up to the higher level where it gets its care and feeding, its training, its integration with that standard force that can do all that, and when it's time to deploy, you task organize and you put a cyber defense team down with a radio battalion team together that's worked together in an IW cell before they deploy and they get down there, or are they together in a certain group all the time down at that lower level? The challenge with that we see on the aviation side is when you push those high-tech capabilities down, they don't have the opportunity to get that training that they need at a higher level when they come back from a deployment.
Autumn. Good morning, General. You appear to have two conflicting needs. One, you want the information operations, you want to push information down to the lower level, but you also have the problem of you're dealing in a high level EW environment. You may lose a lot of your connectivity, GPS, satellite-based communications, that sort of thing. How are you working to do that thing so you can have units operating distributed ops and be maybe in an information denial area?
Now, that's a great question. In fact, I think if you kind of look, Otto, at Expeditionary Force 21, I think you could probably tie that to the Navy's distributed lethality. I mean, if you look at the Navy, they're distributing it also. They come together, they aggregate together when they need to, but they're trying to distribute the force. Things as an example, the Naval Integrated Fires Counter Air, to be able to link those ships, one sensing forward, the other one shooting with another capability from further back, but being able to link them. The same challenge they have is being able to distribute, because they don't want to keep the force together all the time with those high signature together. The same thing what we're seeing on the future, the hybrid threat that we see on the ground with the technology that's out there, that we don't want to stay aggregated. We want to disperse and keep ourselves distributed as we can. But we also see from a maneuver warfare standpoint, as Marines have always seen, is if we can maneuver through distributed forces, we're going to be much more agile and quick and attack and be able to defeat an enemy, because you're going to get somebody that's going to be able to come in undetected. So our distribution is both from a defensive side and from an offensive side. The key part, what you're talking about, though, is we look at EF-21. All of our war games we're doing, whether with the Navy, like on the Naval Services war game we just completed, any of our Ellis war games, we've got a weekly Ellis war game that we've got going on, bring fleet players in from across the Navy and Marine Corps into this weekly. Every single one of them is looking at distributed operations and how we do that. And the challenge with linking them from C2 standpoint, bringing in precision fires down to the lowest level, and also the distribution of logistics is a key part. So everything we're doing in this Force 2025 effort through wargaming, experimentation, and exercises is how do we drive that down to lower levels. Specifically on your piece, Otto, on trying to get information down. From a mission command standpoint, Marines need to operate with mission command orders to be able to operate. That's where I think our advantage is with technology, is to push information down to the lower levels with the tech-savvy youth that we have today. But I also think the advantage is to get them that information, and when they lose it, they're able to operate very independently, in opposed to giving the same technology and losing that technology in a conscript or authoritarian army that we see around the globe that we operate against or with. And so I think that's our advantage, is to be able to do it. So what are things that we're doing? Yesterday I was just co-chair the Naval Board, and I co-chair the Army Marine Corps Board, and one of the things we were looking at is our Track 170s, which is a terrestrial, longer range, medium range capability, and how we replace that. So looking at satellite denied capabilities, how do we build our terrestrial mesh net capability so it's nodal, and it's not centralized. In fact, one of the slides we had up yesterday was the approach we've kind of had to date has been more of a Cold War mentality of it's more centralized. Even our COP and FOB operations that we've been kind of running in Iraq and in Afghanistan kind of drove us to a lot of that we're going to be at a forward operating base. You're going to bring lots of servers in, lots of technology, build that command capability up, and push that information out from that central node. What we're really looking to try to do is connect those into more nodes that you can shift information around very rapidly and quickly, just like electrical distribution nets do on the commercial side today.
Great, thanks. Harlan?
General, I'm Harlan Ullman. Thank you for your presentation. I'd like to ask a broader question in terms of how you are preparing and educating your most precious resource, people, for this future. It seems to me that the best weapons anybody can have are knowledge and understanding. Could you expand on how in the Marine Corps you are imparting greater knowledge and understanding from all levels, from private to general, which it seems to me in this environment, while always important or even more important, and it seems to me that education always gets short shrift in all these particular briefings. So if you could expand on that, I would be grateful.
Yeah, I think education and certainly the training kind of tends to lag in a lot of cases. I think that's a very good point on that and how we stay ahead on that. I think one advantage that I would say that we've got in the Marine Corps, sometimes being a smaller organization allows you to operate in a tighter, you know, timeline, a tighter circle. So I think if I just look at down at Quantico, the responsibility, the capabilities that we have that are underneath me, we've got from concept development that we've got in our futures director at our Marine Corps Warfighting Lab to the Marine Corps Systems Command that's right there with us, along with our Capability Development Directorate that then takes those concepts, those capabilities, develops them into requirements, and then those requirements turned into programs. And then also I have underneath me, under my Marine Corps Combat Development Command hat, is I've got the Training and Education Command underneath me. So we're able to move pretty quickly when we come up with, like, say, Expeditionary Force 21. Taking that concept very quickly within one organization and pushing that all the way down. I just met last week with Brigadier General Helen Pratt, who runs our Marine Corps University. And going through ensuring we're getting all the tenets that we've got even in the draft concept for EF-21 down throughout our education command. But getting specifically at your point on how do we develop these young people today, I think one of our biggest old people, well, that's the harder part, is getting the old people. It really is. The hard part is, like, I think if anything with innovation, it's the people at the bottom, that the young people that are there in any organization are ready to innovate and adapt. It might be the one guy at the top that wants to innovate and adapt, and it's those people in the middle that are the ones that we struggle with. So I think the big challenge is looking to the future and bringing in the right talent. So I'll be honest, we're looking real hard at our recruiting, and we do very well at recruiting. We're very successful in recruiting, but we're looking at raising the bar on our entry-level capabilities on who we bring in, GT scores, and what MOSs do you go to. And what we're seeing is that the entire force we want to raise up to a higher level. There's not going to be in distributed operations all the way down to the infantry level. The example we were looking at in one of the Force 2025 efforts was adding in an assistant squad leader. Bring more seniority in. The Commandant has been pushing us very hard on looking at the special operations model for some of the things they do that's very, very good, where they've got higher rank, more seniority in this tech environment, and bring them in. The challenge we have, too, is keeping them then. Certainly with the new retirement laws that are coming in starting in 18, that's a major concern that General Balakis has. On the MNRA side, is how do you retain this talent when they can pick up and leave anytime they want and take their 401k with them. But we've got a program called the Squad Leader Development Program. We're putting much more emphasis down into education, both online and residency education, and really trying to get at that level of increasing the decision-making capabilities we're bringing in all this new equipment down to the lowest levels. So I think a major effort is on this inside our education and training commands. We've got a big line of effort we've got going on with decision-making tools for commanders. Commanders from the MEF commander all the way down to the lowest level down at the squad level. What we found is, and this is where I think industry can help us, what we found is working with the other services, we have a lot of decision-making tools that can get us down to the lowest level. In fact, we just developed one for one. All our units, as they go through 29 Palms, California, as they go through their rotational pre-deployment training before they go, to be able to get a decision-making tool down to the company commander level and below, to be able to get into that range in a live virtual constructive training environment, look at that and look at their decision-making. So a key part of getting these leaders to think differently is making their decision. Where we're struggling with is with trying to find tools that we can use up at the higher level. We've got it down at the lower level. You get aviation, some of the simulators and link capability that we've got in simulation to be able to get at the individual level or at the strike lead level. Those are all pretty good to put them into that decision-making box. On the ground side and trying to link that up to much higher level MAGTAF, special purpose MAGTAF, MU commander, MEF commander, and MEF exercises, that's an area that we're very interested in driving technology to help us with that from a simulation and decision-making way, just like we do in our aviation simulators.
Great. Okay, the lady back there in the black dress.
General Walsh, HopeSec with military.com. Thanks for taking my question. I wanted to get back to something you said about Force 2025, and it sounded like you indicated there were several options before the commandant. He had to pick one as far as how to develop the force. I was wondering if you could go into detail on what those options are, what are kind of behind those doors, I guess.
Yeah, I can't really go into too much detail because we're just shaping the COAs. But what I would say is we took an interesting approach to it, though. If you look at the Marine Corps planning process, so what we used was, even though we're doing force design, what we said was this has to be collaborative and inclusive. If we just did it behind closed doors down at Quantico, working just with the Commandant one-on-one, we may make some decisions, but they wouldn't be enduring. So what we did is we brought in, we started off with over 200 Marines from across the operating forces and the headquarters Marine Corps to bring them into two separate teams to kind of work this. We thought from a COA, if we used the Marine Corps planning process, everybody's familiar with that. Everybody across the Marine Corps could understand what we're doing and it wouldn't be behind a curtain. So we used the Marine Corps planning process and getting guidance from the Commandant as we developed two courses of action was the approach we went towards. Let's develop two. And so what we did was we took Marines from across it, we brought them in, they worked really for about a couple, 3 months on developing these two courses of action. Started off with the different elements, ground element, air element, logistics, command element. We broke those down, they were just in their own areas working their own piece. We then brought them together into two large groups and made them think Marine Air Ground Task Force. 200 people still at that level point. Over the last 3 weeks, what we did was we broke that down into very small groups. We had about 12 in each group. To really get down to the level of detail we're looking, we have to be in a small group. And really what I had to do is pressurize them to put away their MOS equities. I didn't want them thinking as a Harrier pilot or a artillery officer. I wanted them thinking MAGTAF. Small group forces you to do that much more so. And what we did is we put them in two separate groups. We wanted one group to kind of look at things more from an evolutionary standpoint, one from more of a revolutionary standpoint. We put the younger officers, captains, majors, some lieutenant colonels, in that group to think more revolutionary, out of the box, come up with some really disruptive ideas in that group. In fact, we had another group that really was a disruptive group, very small group that was just all disruptive ideas. But the two COAs that we're designing, and then the other group, the evolutionary group, we used more colonels, more senior, more willing to not move so fast. Let's take this more of an evolutionary pace. Can the Marine Corps really move in that direction that quickly? For example, in the information warfare area, Can we develop the training, the right Marines, get the right equipment in? Can we organizationally design ourselves and get the concepts right? So those two groups have developed their COAs. And now I think what we're going to do is we're going to go into COA wargaming, and we're going to take the two, we're going to take 1st Marine Expedition Force and the 2nd Marine Expedition Force, the operating forces again. Not do it here. Let the operators who know how to do fight a MEB, they're going to ring those COAs out for us. We'll bring it back in, do the COA refinement. This process keeps going back to the commandant, back to the senior leadership. In fact, this in April, our executive offsite, we're going to bring it to all the 3 and 4 stars where we're at right now. And in July, the commandant with senior leadership will select a COA. And that COA will be what will go into phase 2, which will then go into all the .mil PF, all the detailed stuff of how can we phase this in with both budget, time, organization, and how we phase this in really over the next 10 years. Because really what we're trying to design is Marine Corps Force 2025. So it's not going to all happen at once. The vision will be there, what we need to get to, but this will be incrementally phased in over time. We do. I don't have that. What we did decide is we're going to have 1 MEF do one and 2 MEF do the other COA. So we talked about having both of them do one, both COAs and see what comes out. And we decided we're going to kind of just do it separately and focus on one. I don't know if we've picked which COA that they're going to do. That's going to be in what we call MAGTAF Warrior, and that's going to be done during May and June.
Great.
Thank you. Mike Decker, RAND Corporation. First, I wanted to commend the Marine Corps for fighting off an attempt by Special Forces to commandeer the term Advanced Force Ops, or AFO. Sometimes war writing can be as important as war fighting. But in that same context, and this maybe more goes back to your N95 tour than your current tour, what do you think are the odds that because coastal landing beaches are so important to amphibious ops, you know, we do have our own recon and force recon on the MEU, but are we any closer to getting SEAL platoons or any other type of capability like that back on the ARC?
You know, we had that capability, and that was a tremendous capability that we had with the SEAL platoons there, doing a lot of great capabilities. I think if you watched how SOF has changed over the years, they are so low density, high demand, that probably in today's world, even if we wanted to, which we probably would want to, pull them back aboard the ships, they're in such high demand to have them sitting there on a ship waiting for a mission. They're going to be used as a lot of different things in the theater's special operating, you know, TSOCs. So they're going to be out there doing that. And what we have done is we've re-missioned what we call a soft liaison element, soft lees as we call them, on each of the ARGMUs. Those soft lees are SOCOM Marines, not necessarily just SEALs, but SOCOM Marines from Special Ops side, Special Operating Forces, that are on our ARGMUs. And what we're seeing is partnering with SOF, that helps them and it helps us. Because there's a lot of times where SOF has things going on, you know, ashore that's important. It could be counterterrorism mission. They need the capabilities we have, whether it's V-22s, CH-53s, some of our surveillance capabilities, Harriers today, F-35s tomorrow. There's a lot of those capabilities that they need, and we find that pairing works very well. At the same token, is we're pretty smart to know that wherever we're going to go, SOF's going to be there, and probably be there in a lot of cases before we are, and they need us as a, from a conventional capability also. So I think that's a very good Marine Corps SOF integration of what we're doing, that we tried it. It's working very well. We just had the SOCOM Marine Corps warfighter talks down with General Vattel about a month ago down there, and we've agreed to continue to grow that capability on how we integrate. Part of it, I think the SOF forces, they've always been very good at liaison. If you watch how SOF operates, they put liaison just about out everywhere and build relationships. They're very good at that because they don't have all their own capabilities. They have to rely on the conventional forces. And I think it's a good marriage back and forth because we need them, their eyes and ears ashore when we're at sea, and be able to share that information back and forth. They also bring a lot of great capability with them. I'll give you an example of that is our RQ-21s that we're building, our Group 3 UASs. Working with MARSOC, Major General Osterman, we're building this capability. They're shipboard compatible. We're going to put them on, we're deploying them with 22nd MEW for the first time here coming up in this next deployment, and they'll be out there, and how soft will leverage them. But also MARSOC would like to use those with their MSOTs, their Marine Special Operation Teams that we've got in Iraq right now. So we're looking at that of potentially deploying them with our MSOTs. The benefit to us is soft comes with money. They like our truck. They want to put a new piece of gear into the truck. They want to build a signals intelligence package, pay for it with MFP 11 money or money from SOCOM. We get the benefit of that. So there's not only operational benefits from working with them, but they're certainly on the programmatic side also.
Well, thank you. Unfortunately, our time has run out. Please join me in thanking the general for taking time to... who has been released from Capitol Hill in her testimony.
Thank you. Yes, and I'm sorry, General Walsh, to have missed your prepared remarks, but I very much enjoyed the Q&A, and it's so wonderful to have such an innovative thinker inside the Pentagon helping us manage these challenges going forward. So my job is really the easy part, which is to just thank everyone for today. First of all, our sponsor is HII. To Major General Owens, who was here earlier, Lieutenant General Walsh, of course, to Colonel Yamamoto and to Andrew Shearer, and to our own CSIS team, Mark Kansian, for managing everything so well, John Schaus, Andrew Metrick, and all the interns who are running around the microphones. Our goal with this conference really is to help elucidate for us through in the study that we are doing what are the ways in which we ought to be thinking more creatively in the future about how to achieve amphibious ends in the region, thinking about the importance of building partnership capacity, and also through U.S. capabilities that will matter in this region in the future. And from all reports, although I was seconded on Capitol Hill for the morning, from all reports, we have achieved those ends. So again, thank you to everyone for coming, and thank you to Mark.
Okay, and the last couple of items. First, I want to thank our sponsor again, Huntington Ingalls, for their generosity in giving us the opportunity to have this this conference. I would note that as a result of this study effort, we're going to have a report coming out probably within the next month, so you can all see CSIS's analysis in this report. And finally, looking out the window at the break there, the traffic was frocking horrible, and so for you, those of you who are driving back, good luck. thank you all for coming. We appreciate it.